Our first story is about a cello and a suitcase. Please welcome Debora Wondercheck.
I was 10 years old when my journey began. It began with cello on my back and a suitcase in my hand. And you might ask, why do you have that cello on your back? And this is about the size of the cello I would have played at the age of 10. It's on my back because my mom, at the age of 10, desperately wanted to play an instrument at the school that she attended. That school was desegregated, and she saw the opportunity, but was denied that opportunity due to the systemic racism and discrimination that was happening. They denied her the right to play an instrument, and it hurt her deeply. But you know what she did? She said, right at that time, when I'm married and have kids, they're all gonna play an instrument. So she got married, and 7 kids later, here I am, the youngest of 7. We all play instruments, all string instruments and 1 conductor. In my home, it was literally the sound of music. We have the sounds of violins, violas, cellos, even a string bass playing. My mom had the sound of laughter, the sound of joy, the sound of faith. And the sounds that we created were sounds from Vivaldi, from Bach, some jazz, a little bit of R&B, definitely gospel, spirituals, worship music. And it was beautiful. But in our home was also another sound. It was ominous. It was actually a rhythmic cadence. It was a sound that invoked fear. It was a sound that invoked anger and confusion. That's why the suitcase is in my hand. This suitcase is in my hand, and I'm thinking also about the fact that when my mom had all of us, my brothers, the 2 oldest siblings in our family were the ones that received scholarships to universities across the nations for music. And when the 3rd sibling received his scholarship for music across the nation as well, it should have been a time of joy, a whole joyous celebration. But for my mom, it was a calculated time, a time of planning. Because from the time when my brother received his offer letter and the time that he was to go to college was 4 months of strategic planning. Planning and thinking of ways to protect her family. Because my mom was in a volatile, abusive, dangerous marriage. So drastic changes were coming. With 3 older siblings now away at college, safely away at college, my mom knew that she could take care of 4 children on her own. So one night, I put my cello on my back, had my suitcase in my hand, and we escaped. My siblings and I escaped on a train from Chicago to Denver, Colorado. We lived in a woman's shelter for 3 months. And at that shelter, we got a little comfortable. We made friends. We thought, this is it. But then that ominous, rhythmic sound reared its head once again. And we knew we were not going to get caught. So we left from Denver, Colorado, and we moved to San Diego. This time we're in the Salvation Army Center. We stayed there for a few months, but then we had to move again. This time we moved to Oceanside. Now, as a kid coming from Chicago, when you hear a word like Oceanside, you think, we're gonna be at the beach. We're gonna see the ocean. I'm gonna see palm trees, and they're going to have coconuts in them, just like at Gilligan's Island. So we get to Oceanside, and when we get there, we do see the ocean, but we're being driven further and further away, and that ocean at this point is nowhere to be found. The place where we ended up in Oceanside was basically, I was greeted with graffiti because I resided where the Bloods and the Crips lived. It was gang infested. And honestly, once we got to that point, my self-esteem was so low. I felt as if I was invisible. And I just lost all the bubbly joy and confidence that I had. I looked around that place and I thought, this is not my home. At that point, I wasn't able to really even focus a whole lot. I just wanted to be invisible. I couldn't even pray, and we come from a strong faith family. I couldn't pray. All I could do was play. So I played. When I played, I looked up later, of course, and across the street from the women's shelter where we lived was a school, but not just any school. It was an arts magnet school. I was able to go into that school. They actually had an orchestra. I played in the orchestra. I gained so much respect from the teachers, from the students. I began to see myself again. I gained my voice again because of music and the arts that were present at that school. What I began to realize was it didn't make a difference where I lived, what I looked like, what money I did or didn't have. The only thing that mattered was the fact that I was valued. And I was valued with what I played and how I sounded. That is what impacted the lives of those that I worked with and touched at that school. It was wonderful. And what ended up happening is, a few months later, we moved away from the shelter. Stayed at that school, but when we moved away, and at that time, my mom, who was a Head Start teacher, preschool teacher in Chicago, she went back to college to get her degree and was working at another preschool. So she told me one day, she said, I need you to come and play your cello for the kids. I'm thinking, "What in the world? I'm 10. And she said, "Look, you need to come and play because you are blessed to be a blessing. Your instrument will touch the lives of so many of these kids. This might be the only opportunity they'll ever have to touch or see an instrument up close. You are making this accessible to them." So I thought about it. Okay, I'll play for the kids. So I went and I played. I probably just played maybe a scale. I thought, what do preschool kids need? Well, they like Old MacDonald. So I played Old MacDonald. So I played Old MacDonald. And so when we got to the animals, like Old MacDonald had a farm, and on his farm he had a what? Give me an animal, guys.
Cow.
On his farm he had a cow. So we did on his farm he had a cow. And a I had fun with the kids. They did just like you did. We had a great time. And when I saw the laughter on the faces of those children, and I listened to my mom and realized that I had a gift and that it was a calling for me to work with children, it changed my life forever. And what happened is, even today, I created a nonprofit called the Arts and Learning Conservatory specifically to make the arts accessible and equitable to all children, no matter what their background, no matter where they're from. We look for the wonderful gifts in every single child, and we give them a platform to succeed and be successful in life. Our tagline is actually called Confidence and Creativity for Life, and it's because I've lived this that this organization exists, and those who work with me in this organization believe in the power of the arts and what it does for children today. So I'm excited that I was able to share this with you. I'll play one more song, because honestly, if it wasn't for the grace of God throughout the whole thing, I wouldn't be here today.
Thank you.